Yeah, when you finish, if you have a card you want to turn in, just raise your hand, I'll pick it up.
Good evening. Before we get started this evening, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Robert Simpson, President of Cypress College.
Thank you, Jim. I want to express our very sincere appreciation to the League of Women Voters for holding this event. We were talking earlier about the political season, and the adage that all politics is local applies in the face of the national campaigns that are going on. But when you think about the opportunity that citizens have to truly impact their lives, it really is at the local level with our local city councils and our local school boards. And that's what this is about. I have a lot I could say about Cypress College, but that's not why we're here tonight. I want to express my sincere appreciation to all of you in the audience, community members being here. And I hope that we get to learn an awful lot about these candidates. Though this is a local school board election, it truly is important. The North Orange County Community College District has been an exceptional district and is recognized not just statewide but nationally for the good work that's going on. And I know if we make the right selection, that's going to continue. So again, Dan and League of Women Voters, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. Well, I am Jan Wagner, President of the League of Women Voters of North Orange County, and it is our distinct pleasure to be with you this evening. I will be the moderator for this evening's candidate forum. The League of Women Voters is a trusted, nonpartisan political organization. Our members do the hands-on work to safeguard democracy. While we never endorse a candidate, we are directly involved in shaping the important issues that keep our communities strong. As a League of Women Voters member, I have the opportunity to contribute in a leadership role, such as this one, that has an impact on local, state, and even national issues. If you are interested in learning about how you can make a similar impact, I would encourage you to pick up some of the literature on the League's information table in the hall, or visit our website at lwvnoc.org. I have many people helping us here this evening. Our timekeepers, who are right in the front on the corner, are Chris Nelson and Marcia Embry. They will raise signs to signal to the candidates when they have 1 minute, 30 seconds, and stop. Our question sorters are Anita Larson, Dr. Kay Bruce, and Patty Chickahisa. They screen questions to avoid duplication, personal attacks, and questions that do not pertain to the office being sought by these candidates. You will see them writing and conferring. They are not creating questions. I have to say that the most frequent complaint that we receive from the audience is, "You didn't ask my question." Usually that's because we don't have time to get through them all, and that may happen tonight. Oftentimes, though, it is because we have combined like questions, and your question may not sound exactly like the one that was asked, but the topic gets covered. Realize that if you have asked a question that pertains to partisan politics, this is a nonpartisan office, it won't get asked. Personal attacks are exactly that. That does not mean you can't ask pointed questions about the record of a candidate that is seeking this office, but you can ask about their personal lives. Okay, so that's enough of that. We are taping this evening's, the college is taping this evening's event. It will be on their website for future viewing. The League of Women Voters, tonight's sponsors and participants, have not authorized any other video or audio recordings of this forum. If any recordings are made by any member of the audience, we strongly urge that the forum be recorded in its entirety and not be edited in any way. The FCC requires that a videotape of a debate or forum not be edited and must be broadcast in its entirety, either live or reasonably soon after it takes place. Both the FCC and the League want to ensure that information is not manipulated to create false or misleading impressions. Therefore, no candidate is allowed to use or edit footage for campaign purposes. The office tonight is for Trustee for the North Orange County Community College District. It is a special election to fill one vacancy. The candidates for tonight's office, in the order that they are seated, is Mr. Billings, Mr. Blount, Mr. Wongbo, and Mr. Sailhigh. They are seated by the order that they drew lots in a meeting that we had before tonight's forum. They will give their opening statements in the order, starting with the person closest to me. Their closing statements will be in reverse order, and their questions will be asked of them in reverse order. However, all candidates will have the opportunity to answer all questions. There will be questions that will be asked of an individual candidate that may not be applicable to all candidates, and they may choose not to answer if they wish to. So now let's begin with our first candidate, Mr. Billings.
Thank you, Jim. My name is Daniel Billings. First, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for holding this event, for bringing attention and notoriety to this election. I grew up in this district. I was born and raised in La Habra. I've lived my entire life in this district. I went to Fullerton College. From there, I transferred to Whittier College and got a degree in business with a concentration in finance. Later, I went to UCI and got a project management certificate. And finally, I went to Azusa Pacific and got a master's in leadership and organizational structure. None of those had been possible if it weren't for Fullerton College and the North Orange County Community College District. I'm running because this district provided that pathway for me to achieve some personal success. I want to give back to the community that has taught me the value of education. I want to help ensure that that opportunity is available to future students. I'm not interested in another job. I'm not interested in doing anything else. I'm only interested in helping the community that helped me. I appreciate the fact that we get to have this forum tonight, that we get to talk about the issues of this district, that so many people showed up and submitted questions. Thank you for that. I'm glad to be here, and I look forward to this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Billings. Mr. Blount.
I am Stephen T. You can count on Blount. I am presently the president of the Cypress School District and have been on the board of the Cypress School District for 5 years, and in that time I've successfully managed and monitored and argued with the underwriters and the finance people that gave us advice on our bonds. I come from a finance background. For the last 17 years of my professional experience, working experience, I was a controller for a successful manufacturer, 17 years. Before that, I had a bankruptcy consulting practice where I encountered just about every situation involving personalities and money. On the board, I'm the only one here tonight, up here, that has school board experience. And it's been a great experience. We covered everything, and I'm ready to take on a larger role, something that's exciting because of junior college, young adults looking for knowledge they can use and skills that they can use to better their lives. My endorsements, there are 22, which is a partial list of many that I've written down. I involved 6 school district trustees and 4 or 5 superintendents, starting with Alma Harris, who is the superintendent of the Department of Orange County, Department of Education in Orange County. And I'm proud of my endorsements by superintendents. My current superintendent endorsed me because they know me, they know my work, they know what I'm capable of doing and how I represent the Cypress School District and the education in general. You can count on Blount.
Thank you, Mr. Blount. Mr. Wongbo.
Good evening. Let me begin by also thanking Cypress College and also the Women's League of Voters of North Orange County for hosting this event. My name is Steve Ambo. I am a candidate for the special election of North Orange County Community College District, Trustee Area 3. I'm running because I believe the education and training that this district provides is critically important for the academic and vocational success of the people in our community. There is no other higher education institution that is more responsive to the needs of the community and the workforce than community college. I personally benefited from it, so I know community college will continue to open doors for many people in our community. I have extensive experience as a parent of three boys. I have one of the youngest in the audience with me. And also as a community volunteer and activist, and also as a business owner, and also as a policymaker. I have extensive experience in making policies for various public services, and I work with complex budgets for businesses, nonprofit organizations, and local governments. I understand how all levels of government work, and I know how to work with them well. I supported and worked with education community for over 20 years. I served on various school district committees, including bond oversight committees and surplus property committee. I also raised the money for school districts and schools to help students succeed in classroom. It is a challenging but exciting time for community college and continuing education. I will fight for responsible fiscal management and innovative policy making to equip students of all ages to be globally competitive and successful. Again, my name is Steve Wanglo, and I'm number 3 on the ballot for Area 3. Thank you again for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Wanglo. Mr. Salehine.
Thank you for having me. It's good to be back. A little over 20 years ago or so, I was here at Cypress College, and God, time goes by so quickly. Everything goes by in a flash. I graduated here, went on to UCLA, and did my graduate work at USC. I started an educational technology company shortly afterwards. Then the technologies that I patented in 1999 through 2001 are now being used by Microsoft, Cisco, and University of Phoenix. Started out in interactive education, then went on to biotechnology. Shortly thereafter, I retired as far as day-to-day operations were concerned, and I started giving back to my local community. I moved up to this area, again, right around that time, to help with the 39ers Association along Beach Boulevard to grant more federal funds and state funds to Highway 39, the only road that goes from the mountains to the sea. I am an avid student of life, and I look forward to helping, and that is why I was the primary proponent for this election. It's been over 20 years since there's been an election for this district, for an open seat. And you have to ask yourself why. There's been misinformation provided as far as how many signatures would be even required, whether or not there's even trustee area requirements for such things, deadlines, dates, and I ask the people to ask yourselves why. The time for change is now, and I believe we can make that change together in three parts. The first and most important part is accountability and transparency. Currently, the Fullerton College Police Academy is uncredited, and who is to take responsibility for that? Instead of our board members taking responsibility, they pass it on to administrators. There has to be accountability. We have diversity issues where our racially diverse population is an achievement gap, and we must take responsibility. And finally,
you,
we must
Mr.
put
Salehine.
More money
Mr.
into
Salehine.
Our classroom instead of
Thank
for our administrative
Mr.
faculty.
Salehine.
Together we can
over,
make our
Mr.
community
Salehine.
Great again.
Would you turn off the microphone, please? Thank you. Our first question is for Mr. Salehine. You have 1 minute. You've run for multiple offices from school board to U.S. Senate and just about every office in between. Are you sincerely interested in the North Orange County Community College District, or is this just a stepping stone for you?
Thank you, Beth. Yes, I think that it's important that we look at our responsibilities as individuals and as citizens. I've been an elected trustee for the Bonaparte Library District. I was re-elected again and won in 2014. In that capacity, I have been one voice in helping create and expand a host of opportunities, and essentially also with our online opportunities and our passport services. When I first took office, we were in a negative financial situation and we were considering a possible bankruptcy. But now we are back in the black. We're even open on Mondays. I think that thinking outside of the box is imperative. And I take no shame in standing up and trying to be the best citizen that I can be. If I am in some way gifted in any ways, if I have anything to offer, I've been raised to be able to put myself out there and have the people decide. If I am later called to serve at a higher capacity, if the people at any point in time feel that I can help them, I am here to serve.
Thank you. Our next question is from Ms. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Blount.
Yes, I've been in, living in Area 3 for 40 years, and my friends of 40 years, 35, 30 to 40 years, have variously, at times, encouraged me to run for high office. But as a volunteer and then as a board member, I don't think there's any higher calling and more effective public service than in education, so that I have no aspirations for higher office, and I ran for city council once and the state assembly once, but in comparison, this is where I want to be.
Thank you. Mr. Wormwood.
Thank you. I've been serving on city council for the last 5 years, and I already served as mayor of my city. So people ask me, are you doing this as any kind of stepping stone? You know, if you're doing it as stepping stone politically, you do it the other way around. You run for school district, and then you run for the city council. I think the serving and helping students of all ages is a higher calling, in my opinion, than serving on the city council. That's why I seriously, when people begin to come to me and ask me to run, even though I was concerned whether I have enough time to serve on this or not, I felt that I was compelled to at least to run and ask voters if they feel that I'm fit to serve on the college board.
Thank you.
As the spouse of a high school chemistry teacher, I have no interest in running for anything else. Education is paramount in our house. We believe in the mission of education. We believe in the values and the experiences I can bring for students. I'm interested in serving this community, this very specific community, and only this community.
Thank you, Mr. Billings. Our next question is for Mr. Wongo, and it is a question that was addressed to all candidates. Mr. Wongo, what are the issues facing the college that you would like to tackle?
I think there's a lot of exciting thing going on in this district. Especially, I think community college is a great tool. For a lot of people, it's a second chance for academic reasons or for vocational reasons. The challenges that all public agencies have these days is the control of the pension cost. I understand the board has been doing a pretty responsible job of putting away and setting up the irrevocable trust and putting away some money. I understand the unfunded liability for this district is about $130, $140 million, and they put away $70 million. I think the fiscal management is going to be most challenging because, again, you know, the K-12 school districts get about $8,000 per student. Maybe Cal State gets about $12,000 per student. Maybe UC gets about $20,000 per student. But community colleges get $5,000 per student. And that's what we have to deal with. Yet we provide most flexible and most diverse programs to help students academically also.
Thank you, Mr. Bonner. Mr. Blount.
Yeah, I go back to the biggest issue or concern or opportunity challenge is a $574 million construction bond measure. And not only my 5 years monitoring and administrating and being fully involved in the decision making, which school to do next, what to include and not include in a particular school, has made me given me a good position to do it for the NOCCCD area, well, for the whole thing, but representing Area 3. And then in private practice, as a controller or a senior staff accountant or accounting manager, I've overseen large construction projects, and I'm dedicated to making getting the most out of our bond and with the least burden to our taxpayers.
Thank you. Mr.
pension costs, fiscal management, how to spend money, construction projects. I think those are challenges that every district faces. But if we want to talk about this district specifically, I think the biggest challenge right now is the interim chancellor and the full-time permanent chancellor position. Interim Chancellor Williams has been serving in that role for a little while now and has no interest in taking that job full-time. The board has hired a consultant to help with the search for a new chancellor. Interviews start as soon as next week, I think. The choice for that chancellor is going to have long-lasting impacts for this district. It has to be right. That choice has to be right.
Thank you. Mr. Salehi.
Yes, I'm a solutions-oriented man. I will identify the problems, but at the same time, I try to offer solutions for them as well. The fact of the matter is that we're looking at a community college district that can offer great potential. It can be a beacon of hope for those who are coming around for a second chance, but it can also be an amazing platform for those who are advanced. For example, in the audience tonight is my little brother. Can you stand up, Armand, for a moment? Armand went to Oxford Academy, and at the age of 14, he took the CHESPE exam and is currently an honor student here at Cypress College. Has a 3.9 GPA in the last semester and is now 15 years old. He is moving forward with a TAP program into UCI because this is the way that we need to brand our community college. It is not a place of last resort, but it can be a place of first choice. We need to look at the other issues of creative financing. Some other school districts right here in Orange County have gone to other countries and are putting outsourced resource locations and earning money into their districts. We can solve problems by thinking outside of the box and being solution-oriented.
Thank you. Before I go to the next question, I have neglected to ask you all to please turn your cell phones off. If you have not done so already, please do so. Our candidates have been instructed not to have cell phones at the podium, so I don't need to worry about them. But the rest of us, please make sure your cell phones are in silence. Our next question would be directed to Mr. Blount, and it is also directed to all candidates. Measure J recently passed. Have you attended any of the community meetings about the master plan for voting?
Yes, I have. One last July, it was widely publicized, but there were maybe three or four people there that weren't directly involved with the Measure J, but the speakers were great, got a lot of information, collected a lot of business cards, sat next to our interim chancellor, and appreciated getting to know him. And that excited me about the possibilities that could be done with the $574 million, and I'm anxious to get started.
Thank you. Mr. Billings?
I have attended a community forum on Measure J. It was in October. It was held at Fullerton College. What I did was invited the community, the residents in the neighborhood, and talked about how those construction projects were going to impact the residents. Parking, noise, light pollution, traffic, even so much as to talk about the trash left on the yards of the homeowners. It was very well attended. We got to hear opinions from all the residents. What I thought was most interesting in that particular meeting was the residents didn't agree with each other on what project should be done. And I thought it was very good forum for the residents to learn that even though they might be in the same situation as their neighbor, they might not think the same way. It was a very good experience for those residents to hear from administration about what the projects might be, what order they might be in, and especially how those projects were going to be communicated to the neighbors.
Thank you. Mr. Salehi.
Yes, I have attended, and it's actually an excellent point that you bring up. I'd like to talk about Measure J because it is a near and dear issue to my heart. As many of you may already be aware, this measure passed by less than 20 votes in our district. As I'm happy that the money is there, $500 million, to be quite honest with you, you have to ask yourself, where is it? The majority of that money, the fact of the matter is that it sits with Wall Street bondbrokers. It's not even here in our district to be used. And unfortunately, this issue was placed before the voters because the fear was that the voters would not pass a measure to take money and put it directly into the classroom, to hire better educators, to provide a higher quality of education for our students and better prepare them, to create better vocational programs for the future of our community. This is the kind of bond measure that I'm looking for and that I would like to support when I'm elected as your next representative of the NOCCCD. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sohai. Mr. Washam.
Yes, I didn't have a chance to attend the public hearing for that, but I am currently serving on the bond oversight committee of the two local school districts, Cypress School District and also Anaheim Union High School District, because I've seen 12, 13 years ago how the voters approved the bond for local schools and money was mismanaged. To me, the management of the money is very important. Another concern that I have is that school districts, it looks like we are getting comfortable going back to the taxpayers to pay for a lot of facility upgrades and technology upgrades. I think we have to, since the voters approved it, we have to be very careful how we spend the money. I had a talk with the chancellor about this, and he was explaining to me how his plan was, how he's going to spread it out for the next 25 years and all that. So if I get elected, if I'm on the board, I'll be very careful of watching and making sure that money is spent wisely.
Thank you. Our next question is directed to Mr. Billings, but again, it is a question for all candidates. Are you familiar with the accreditation issues with the police academy? What does the district need to do?
I am familiar with the accreditation issues with the police academy. The police academy was unaccredited this year. In my opinion, it was due to a misunderstanding of how important the criteria was for accreditation. The first step that the district took was to verify that the students who had recently graduated were in fact holding valid certificates. They were. The second step the district took was to ensure that the current enrolled students found other programs that they could enroll in. The third step was for the district to start working closely with the accreditation. I know that the president of the Fullerton College has been hands-on trying to remedy the situation.
Thank you. Mr. Sohai.
Oh, excellent. First of all, unbelievable. Unbelievable. We are in a community college district where we are putting people through school and then after the fact they realize that their degree and their certificate is worthless, putting their jobs at risk, putting the community at risk, tarnishing the reputation of our community college district. And what is the response from our community college district? It is to take a pass. Our community college district isn't even fighting to recertify. We are simply trying to come up with methods moving forward. And for the record, this is not just this year. This started technically towards the end of a year and a half ago, and the internal memos were available over 5 years ago, according to the OC Register, pointing to this problem. We have been aware of this issue. We could have been proactive regarding this issue, and I will make sure, as a board member, to take public responsibility for this issue moving forward.
Thank you. Mr. Wong.
Thank you. It is a serious issue, losing accreditation for an important program like Police Academy. A lot of local governments depend on that program also to recruit the policemen as well. I don't know all the details, but yes, the leadership, I think, and the board has failed in this case. And I think we have to look for ways to learn from this so that we can prevent this kind of problem in the future. It seems to me like there wasn't enough more effective communication within the organization. How can leadership not, district leadership not know what's going on at the campus? So, I look forward to looking more into this. And also, again, in any organization, communication is extremely important. Timely communication, accurate information, so that this kind of thing doesn't happen. Who loses are the students who worked hard towards this, who are involved in the program, hoping that they will be able to finish the program and move on. Stop, sorry.
Mr. Blount.
Yes, I was surprised and the word that comes with greed. And I thought, well, you know, I'm very familiar with the program at Golden West College, and I'm very proud of that, and I would like to see it duplicated at Fullerton College. But I got to say, my wife's best friend at the university she worked for 19 years was headed up the accreditation write-up for that university, and she pulled many all-nighters to do it. And, you know, to meet all the nuances and the supposes and you know, just honorary, malicious requirements for accreditation is beyond me. And you know, I second it, but I don't think it's that serious. And then once they, you know, fulfill those requirements, I can see a vibrant and very successful police academy at Fullerton College.
Thank you. Our next question is directed to Mr. Salehi, and Mr. Salehi, this one is addressed to you specifically. It says, your register devoted your parents' business address. Do you actually live in the district?
Oh, absolutely. First of all, as you may already know, I am an elected trustee for the Buena Park Library District. I've been serving there for many, many years. That particular district requires a residency, and so if there has been any shadow of doubt, as you've mentioned, I've been a perennial candidate, I would have been investigated a long time ago and in the custody of the same chief of police that I'm trying to help now with this Fullerton College situation. Did you know that in Buena Park alone, we have 5 police officers that are actually impacted by this decreditation of the Fullerton JC board? This is an issue that we need to look at because it's actually impacting the way that we live our lives. So I look forward to remedying that issue along with any form of misconception. And then on that same subject, just to mention that family business has a house that is on the master plan for the city, and it is actually a house in which I live. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any Mr.
Wong, you wish to answer? That's the disclosure. I'm a homeowner in this district for 24 years, and I have voted in every single election.
Thank you. Does anyone else wish to answer this question? Okay, we're going to move on. Our next candidate is Mr. Wongbo. And Mr. Wongbo, this one is directed to you. It's kind of a follow-up question to one that was addressed earlier. Would you quit being a city councilman if you were to win this election?
You know, if I have to choose between the two, if I get elected to the community college trustee board, and if I have to choose between the two, yes, I will choose to serve on the community college district. I think it's much more rewarding for me. That's something I've been passionate about, supporting and helping public education for the last 20-some years. My wife is a public school educator, and all my adult life, I always invested my time, my effort, to help the students of all ages to improve themselves with education and training. So, but I was told that I can serve on both, but if I have to choose between the two, I would choose to serve on the college board.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'd like to follow up on that.
Okay, Mr. Salehi.
The issue of conflicting offices is a clear-cut case outlined by the Secretary of State. Currently, in the state of California, there are no school board members or city council members that serve dual roles on community college district. It does not exist, it will not exist, and there's a reason for that. There's a competition in Sacramento for funds. Commingling of funds or commingling of interest for those funds is strictly prohibited. So therefore, if a termed-out council member or a school board member does not want to give up their seat, what they will be doing effectively by taking this seat is creating undue legal burden moving forward, and the taxpayers are going to have to pick up that cost. The fact that that choice has not been made or predetermined now is unacceptable. The people need to know where the candidates lie with their decisions moving forward, as it will directly impact our decisions and our legal liabilities moving forward. I urge for that kind of clarity and that kind of transparency from my fellow candidates. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Our next Mr. Blum.
Yeah, I can't serve on the Cypress School District Board of Trustees and the North Orange County Community College District at the same time. And the legal term for it is that I have to forfeit my Cypress trusteeship, which I'm would not like to do, but I accept the laws of the land and I find reason to justify them. The truth is, I'm retired. I can commit 24/7, 365 to whatever I need to do to make the North Orange County Community College District a very successful in enhancing the education of countless thousands of students in the future.
Would you just speak, Mr. Burns? Please do.
I don't have to make that choice.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our next question is for Mr. Blount, and it is directed to all candidates. How many North Orange County Community College District Board meetings have you attended?
One, because I found out that while you get to know the personalities of the board members, you don't really, and you know, one or two of them already know, the real business is done in closed session. So it might seem like a good choice to go to a board meeting, but it's not really all that people might think. And but I look forward to wrestling with the issues and with my other board members in closed session.
Thank you, Mr. Burns.
I think it's a fascinating meeting to attend. I think you should do it if you have the time. Since the minute I thought I might want to be a board member, I've been attending board meetings. I haven't missed one. I attended the one in July where the board discussed and vetted out various engineering firms that might be eligible to bid on Measure J construction projects. I went to both meetings in August where I was provisionally appointed to join the board. Also in August, they reviewed their investment report. They reviewed the quarterly finance report. I went to both meetings in September where they reviewed the proposed budget for the year. And the Associated Student President Thor Rowe voiced a resolution opposing even having the special election. I went to both meetings in October, where state and federal advocacy priorities were reviewed. I went to both meetings in November, where the annual reports and institutional effectiveness reports were reviewed. I went to the one meeting in December where the board voted to build a brand new science, math, and engineering building instead of remodeling the current one.
Thank you, Mr. Billings. Mr. Salehide?
As many of you may be aware, the minutes fully are available to every single meeting online. I have been following, and in preparing to assume the role and the responsibility of a trustee, every minute that has been published for the last decade I have reviewed. I am very, very confident in my knowledge of the internal operations of the district. I look forward to sharing that with the community. One of the things that is highlighted over and over again in those meetings is the issue of adjunct faculty. Adjunct faculty needs parity with their full-time faculty members. The fact of the matter is, just recently, a pregnant, part-time, full-time faculty member was denied sick leave, a basic human right, sick leave, while she was pregnant. This is unacceptable in our day and age, and we need to look forward to offering those kind of opportunities for the people that educate our students.
Thank you. Mr. Palmer.
I have not been able to attend any of the board meetings physically. I think the gentlemen, they were attending at least one meeting because they participated in the appointment of the disposition. But yes, as he pointed out, I was looking for the audio or video tape of the meetings, but you don't have it on your website. I was looking forward to that. But I did read minutes, and I tried to learn all the issues that's going on in the district.
Thank you. Our next question is directed at Mr. Billings. It is a question, however, for all candidates. How do you characterize the mission of the community colleges? What opportunities do you believe we should pursue in the future?
I characterize the mission of the community college as very much part of the community. I believe very few people travel from other states to come here to a community college. The community college is embedded in the community which it serves. It's a community that I grew up in, that I live in now, that I would like to serve. One area that I think that the mission can be improved is with technology. Many four-year schools have online programs, full online degrees. I would like to see the community college system, specifically North Orange County, really embrace that, offer degrees that are strictly online, so we can reach a wider audience instead of just the community that we serve. We can broaden that community.
Thank you. Mr. Salehi.
I am looking to expand opportunities and resources for our school district. I think that, first of all, rebranding is going to be a primary issue, and advertising. I think that our community needs to look and realize and be told what kind of opportunities we have. The second thing is we need to actually expand our opportunities. We need to look at the next century. The average bachelor's degree, according to Money Magazine, is going to cost anywhere from $400,000 to $500,000 by the year 2020. We need to look at vocational programs. We need to look at better preparation. We need to look at early orientation programs for our graduating seniors in our local high schools. These are the kind of things that I'd like to look at. I also like to look at more specific technological solutions, not just a blanket technology solution, but to specifically look at matriculation programs. We right now have the opportunity to look at exactly where a student is falling behind. I don't want to say a Spanish guy. I don't want to say a black guy. I'm going to say Susie and Steve are failing, and I want to know why, and I can with today's technology.
Thank you, Mr. Salehi. Mr. Juanjo.
This is where the community college is really exciting, the flexibility. You know, community college system is about 115 years old. When it first began, with one campus, it mainly provided liberal arts education. But during 1930s, during recession, it provided the vocation, the job training for those people who are looking for jobs. And when veterans came back from wars, the community colleges were utilized to equip those veterans to go back into the society with the jobs. A lot of, if you look at the course programs for community colleges that we have in our system, they offer a variety of different things, not only academic subjects, but also how to fix the car bodies and repair cars and technology, how to program computers and nursing and police academy and all different things. It's exciting how that the community college system can really respond to the needs of the workforce and the community. And that's what's really exciting, that's what attracts me.
Thank you. Mr. Blount.
Yes, while I was working for Best Foods, managing contracts for Best Foods, I got a certificate in business management at Cypress College, and then through the years, I took computer programming courses, and the last course I took was in essay writing, and that's archetypical of the community, coming to the junior college to take a course that is important to you, that enriches your life, prepares you for something better, that you want to be a part of. And my son went there for automotive technology, and it's something he was interested in. And I appreciate the faculty, because they could teach the courses, they've done it in life, but they had colorful lives that enriched us and had, for better, lack of a better word, war stories, just experience of life, and their counseling was very important. And the welcoming to the community at large. And that's more than you can say for other universities or colleges.
Thank you. This question is for Mr. Salehi, and it is directed to Mr. Salehi. Why were you successfully sued by the Orange County Registrar of Voters Office?
Oh, okay. That's actually a partial story. What happened was, effectively, that year, the state of California had an online registration, voter registration program that they rolled out. Unfortunately, there was a bug in the program, and multiple people who signed up for that voter registration program did not receive voter registration cards, nor did they receive voter registration materials in many cases, and that's been very well documented. I then raised an issue and took the county to arbitration and won my case. After winning my case, the only route that the county had at that point was to pursue the issue civilly. And this particular issue has not actually been resolved. It's currently still involved in the courts pending an outcome which will be found in the next 6 months. But I do look forward to that kind of transparency on this board. For this last 45 years, we've been looking at a board that does not answer to the people, and that is what we're looking forward to solving together.
Thank you, Mr. Silver. Does anyone else wish to answer that question? No. Okay. Our next question is for Mr. Wongbo, and it is directed to all candidates. What is the role of adult education in the community college system?
Well, we all know that the community college system serves largely two roles. Young people who want to continue their academic career by moving on to four-year colleges and universities. And the question, I think, refers to adult education, continuing education, or any of the programs that we have within the community colleges. Again, if you look at the your classroom schedules, accounting, nursing, the mechanics, auto mechanics, or body repair, and all the important things that will help people to better themselves so they can be better equipped to get the better paying jobs so they can support their families. That's what's exciting about community college system. It can serve those people who want academic success in classroom, move on to pursue higher degrees in four-year universities and grad school and all that, but at the same time, it provides actual training and the education that people need so they can, I was told to stop.
Thank you, Mr. Mr. Blount.
Yes, in this day and age, you need a license, a certificate, a credential for just about any skilled job. And that's what the adult education provides. People that want to get these, qualify for these licenses and credentials and certificates can get it at the junior college level. And that's really a godsend for them that they've changed careers, they found something that they like and they want to pursue it at a community college because it provides the technical training that qualifies them for these state mandated requirements.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
We talk a lot about Fullerton College, we talk a lot about Cypress College, but one of the great things about this district is that is included the school continuing education. The school continuing education has 35,000 students. It's the size of Cal State Fullerton. There are classes for that for the school that range from learning how to swim to balancing a checkbook to raising a child to learning a foreign language. In terms of specifically adult education, it's true that you need a certificate for a lot of things, but if you just want to learn a skill, that's how you do it. You take a class.
Thank you. Mr. Simha.
We have an amazing opportunity here at the NOCCCD. You know, the School of Continuing Education, we actually have a pharmacy program that is paid for. You can actually start your initial steps moving forward to a full profession that is covered. For people who are studying English as a second language, you have an opportunity to stand up and learn your English language, in many cases subsidized by that community college district. I think that the number of options that we offer are amazing, but they can be expanded on. The fact of the matter is that we need to focus more specifically on student success. Without student success, our degrees are worthless. We need to look at exactly where our students are failing and why. We need to allocate resources, tutors, to gear up and put the mindset forward to putting our education and our students first. Money needs to be put into the classrooms, not to pay the inflated overhead of administrative salaries.
Thank you. Our next question is for Mr. Blount, and it is directed to all candidates. Talk about your experience managing budgets.
Well, I've done it for 34 years. I was promoted out of the mailroom with Best Foods in Doe County. Immediately took responsibility for DTI, depreciation, taxes, insurance, and overhead budgeting. And every year I'd have to, twice a year, had to do projections and forecasts. Then I moved, as I moved up in accounting and different companies, I had to do the same on a, with more responsibility and more consequences for my errors. And then as a controller, I did it all. And as a board, a school board member, I have to go through page by page to familiarize myself and make decisions on the budget for a school district.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
I have a degree in finance. I've worked for three major companies. When I worked for Sherwin-Williams, I managed commercial paint stores. I was responsible for the profit and loss statement for my store every month. We looked at revenues, different types of revenues. We looked at expenses, how the money was being spent. That budget was in the tens of millions of dollars. For Edison, I work for Southern California Edison in construction. We manage multi-million dollar construction projects on a daily basis. My specific job right now is to manage contracts. So I have a contract. We're building a building on the campus of Cal Poly Pomona, one of our partners. We go through budgets for that project weekly. When I worked for Disney, my job was to handle budgets for a group of stores inside Disneyland. For a long time, I had Frontierland that has revenues upwards of $25 million a year that we looked at budgets for.
Thank you. Mr. Sampai.
In my capacity as a elected trustee for the Bonaparte Library District, when we were going and facing a potential bankruptcy, I was selected with one of my former board members, Donna Miller. Donna Miller, as many of you already know, was a former NOCCCD member who also served, just like myself, as a library district trustee for Bonaparte and simultaneously as a board member for the NOCCCD. Obviously, there's no conflict there. And the fact of the matter is that it was only me and her that were selected to be budgetary pioneers, essentially, and helped to balance the budget. Because of that budget, subsequently, we're afloat and we're actually in the positive. In the private sector, I'm the chairman of an educational and biotechnological company called Glancing Interactive. I oversee a multi-million dollar budget there as well. But in my past, I've also been an interim CTO for Coats VLA in Brown. It's based in London, and the office is operating in Manchester, England. That is actually a multi-billion dollar budget, and effectively part-time also at the Speech and Debate Club for UCLA.
Thank you. Mr. Guangbo?
Do I have to? I have pretty extensive experience with the budget, a very complex budget, both in private sector and public sector, this being a somewhat a public sector organization providing service to the public and using taxpayers' money. Again, I have 6 years of working on city budget, which is very, very diverse, including infrastructure related and water related and police related, public safety related, and community service related, recreation related, and also for nonprofits and for the church. And so all my, most of my adult life, I had to deal with some type of a budget, both in private sector and public sector.
Thank you. The next question I have is for Mr. Sailhai, and it is directed to all candidates. Talk about your experience in education.
Oh, I'd love to. It's my favorite subject. Okay, so I was born and raised here in Orange County, California, in 1978. And my family comes from Iran, and there's a Persian expression. They say, "Zegah barita gur danish beju," means from the crib to the grave, seek knowledge. It is something that has been instilled in me and in my family for the longest time. I look forward to having the opportunity to extend those opportunities that I've had to my fellow citizens. I have invented and patented an educational technology software that extends the opportunity to our world-class education systems right here in America to everywhere around the world, and it is currently being used in multiple countries, countries that do not have the same opportunities that we do. I like to expand that kind of edge and that kind of influence that we have by creating higher interpersonal communication effective solutions in our classrooms and into the future.
Thank you. Mr. Wongo?
Yes, that's the question people are asking me. You're on the city council, and why are you running for a college education board? I just don't talk about supporting education. Actually spend a lot of my personal time and my resources. For example, like I've been serving on the foundation as a president of the Oxford Academy Foundation, which is at one point number two school in the entire country, number one school in California. I raised over $500,000 to put more computers and technology into classrooms, challenging teachers to incorporate more technology into instruction because younger generation responds better that way. I served on the various the school district committees because, again, it's important for me to serve on those committees to provide citizen oversight, and also served on the district foundation to raise money for the district. Again, I see the stop sign.
Thank you. Mr. Blum.
Yes, give a shout out, because I'm going to read this as fast as I can when my time is up. Shout out. President Cypress School District Board of Trustees, President Cypress School District Public Financing Corporation Board of Directors, Member Greater Anaheim Special Education Local Plan Area Board of Directors, Director of Corporate Foundation Relations, Friends of Morris Charitable Education Foundation. At the Cypress School District, helped recruit and hire two superintendents, successfully completed modernization of the district school facilities utilizing $53.6 million Measure M bond funds, successfully closed escrow on two income-generating properties, Friends of Health and Charitable Education Foundation, liaison to corporations, foundations, and Chambers of Commerce, Chairman Cypress School District Advisory Committee for School Reopening, Vice Chairman Cypress School District Advisory Committee on Uses of Surplus Property, Member of Cypress School District Advisory Committee, School Facilities Construction, Chairman Arnold Elementary School Business School Partnership Program, Member Cypress School District Advisory Committee, Member Cypress School District School Site Council, PTA Vice President
Thank
Cypress
you,
School
Mr.
District.
Blunt. Mr. Billings.
As I mentioned, my wife is a high school chemistry teacher. Every day she stands outside of her classroom. She shakes the hand of every student that walks in her door. She smiles at them, looks them in the eye, and welcomes them into her class. We understand, and I've learned through her, that education isn't about students. It's about people. And we like to think of them as students, but in reality, they're human beings. Because of that, we have just a lifelong dedication to the students that we want to serve.
Thank you. Our next question is for Mr. Wongo, but it is directed to all. What role do you believe unions should play in educating North Orange County Community College District students?
I think unions' role in any public organization, public sector organization, is important because that gives them a voice, and their voice needs to be heard. But ultimately, the board members, the management, the faculty, whether you're part of the union or not, we only serve one people, that is the students. So I think as long as a union and everybody else who are serving the students as a part of this district organization is focused on that, I don't have any problem with the union. I think a union needs to have the right to voice their needs. And I understand right now the part-time instructors are having some issues, and I think maybe their compensation needs to be looked at more carefully. Maybe somewhat the district's financial resources are somewhat limited, but there are issues. That's why their unions exist, and they need their voice needs to be heard. And at the stop sign.
Thank you. Mr. Blount.
Yes, speaking from experience for the Cypress School District and third, our union representatives, our locals, Association Cypress Teachers, our full partners, collaborating with us to put students first and to get make possible the best education benefit to our students, whether it's transportation by bus or textbooks or teaching materials or professional development. And we have an amazing cooperation that the president of the classifieds and the certificated have both endorsed me, and because they know me, they know my work, but they know my attitude, my love for students and people.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
Unions are a polarizing topic. A lot of people are either very much for them or very much against them. Whatever side you're on, people should have the right to collectively bargain. The adjunct faculty for the North Orange County interviewed the four of us and have decided to endorse me.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Salem.
I think it's important to look at the specific issues that are involved in negotiations. Regardless of what you call yourself, whether you're a union or a group, you are representative of a series of concerns that bind all of us, especially in our district. As far as the adjunct faculty is concerned, I've already mentioned a series of stipulations and technicalities that are being used against it. But more specifically, I think parity is imperative, and I don't believe that it is outside the realm of possibility. In other school districts, for example, Golden West, their adjunct faculty actually has options of health benefits, which we do not. And if in some poor cases, if our adjunct faculty members do not get timely payment, they're struggling for money during periods of time. Did you know that they actually have to file unemployment in between classes to be able to move forward? That is the way that it is dictated. These kind of systems need to be evolved, and those forms of unions are the ones that I want to help to support to secure a better tomorrow.
Thank you. Our next question is for Mr. Blount. It is directed to all candidates. As the new trustee, how do you intend to represent students?
First, by getting to know them. Again, I go back to my wife, who was an on-campus student housing manager at a university, and the mothers and the fathers had a different opinion of what their child needed in the university experience. So the first thing is to get to know the students on an individual level and find out what they want, what they need, what they expect, and what they hope to gain.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
As a trustee, all decisions will be made with a student focus. Students are what we do. It's the core business. Student success is the only reason we exist. If there's not going to be student success, then none of us really would have a job. In order for that to happen, you have to be an advocate for the student. I know several of us, but me specifically, we were a student at this school, one of the schools in this district. We know what they're going through. I understand the struggles of trying to get classes, of trying to pay for classes, of trying to buy books, of trying to buy books that was written by the professor. All decisions will be made with a student focus, and that's how you do it.
Thank you. Mr. Salehi.
The primary function of the Board of Trustees is to find an appropriate chancellor. We call it the CEO of the district. Finding that chancellor, then we develop a multi-point plan with the chancellor and the subsequent hierarchy of administrators to then ultimately derive better programs and student success. And over a $200 million budget, we do have the funds to achieve that goal. However, we are not currently at our optimal level. We have an amazingly educated community, but unfortunately our student success rates compared to other comparative community colleges in the state are failing. We can do better and we will do better, and some of the ways that we can do that are by offering more tutors, by increasing our technology for matriculation assessment, by offering more adjunct faculty with better compensation so we get better cream of the crop, by rebranding, by advertising, and letting the community know what kind of things we have to offer, and by bringing that kind of parity into play between our classrooms and our administration.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Blanco.
I think everything you do as a board is serving the students. However, as I said before, in any organization, communication is extremely important. If we exist to serve the students, I think we need to provide means and tools to hear from them what their needs are. Because we want, when we set our curriculums or when we set our programs, we want to make sure they're designed to serve the best, the interest of our students. Are we helping them or are we hurting them? So again, I think everything will be focused on that. If I get elected, that's one area that I'll be looking into to see if there's a good tools that exist within the organization, within the campuses, for better communication with the students and from the students.
Thank you. Our next question is for Mr. Billings, and it is directed to Mr. Billings. Why do you think you were appointed by the board in August over the other candidates?
As you know, Donna Miller retired midterm. The board made public that they were going to appoint somebody. Several people applied. We were all vetted that night in August 25th. After some deliberation, some voting, the board unanimously selected me. Many of those board members, some of them are here tonight, many of them are endorsing me for this position. I believe they selected me because I was someone they wanted to work with. The board speaks with one voice. That voice has to be consistent, has to be able to work with each other. And through that vetting process and the question and answer period and the resume, the letter writing, the board thought I would be the best choice for the job.
Thank you.
I'd like to comment on that topic.
Yes.
I recently received a promotional advertisement from Mr. Billings in my home. On that promotional advertisement, as required by law, what was missing was a return address and an FPPC ID number. All funds that are in a campaign must be reported by law, and this particular type of character is, by state definition, illegal. Effectively, we need to look at the kind of people that our board is choosing. Are we choosing someone who's going to change the status quo, or are we choosing someone who's going to be a rubber stamp? This is why I have fought tirelessly to bring this issue to the people, and that is why we've received several thousand signatures to create this opportunity for the people and to have the people decide who they want to best reflect the future of our community college districts. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr.
Wambody,
do you want to speak?
Yes, I understand there are five people who applied for appointment. I was not one of them. And three of them are here on this stage. And I understand it took four rounds of voting before they selected or appointed a person. I understand during the first round, a person who's not here received three votes, three out of six. And another person who's here received another vote. And a couple of people up here did not receive any vote. So I think it was a kind of struggle for the whole board before they actually decided on this person after four rounds of voting.
Thank you. Okay. Our next question is for Mr. Salheim. It is directed to all candidates. I can tell you that judging from my watch, we are probably down to our last two, perhaps three questions. What do you think about President Obama's proposal for free community college education for everyone and what its impact would be on the Orange County Community College District?
I love it. I think that education in America is a national security issue. It is my personal top priority to see that our community moving forward is in fact well prepared to meet the challenges of the 21st century. I believe that that is possible. I believe that when our economic opportunities are met, so do our family obligations are fulfilled. I believe that when we're looking at other issues in terms of raising the minimum wage, we can actually have more effective individuals fight for the top posts, for the top quality jobs. I think that higher education creates better equality, both along the racial divide and the gender divide. I think that the answer to everything is in education. We look to Proverbs and we look to Matthew 7:11, and we say that asking you shall receive. You know that if you were to give a man a fish, he will eat for a day. But teach a man a fish and he will eat for a lifetime. And that is what I'm looking forward
Thank
to creating
you,
in the new century.
Mr. Longwell.
You know, the community college plays a very, very important role in that. The other day, last week, I believe, the SCAG, SCAG, Southern California Association of Governments, they have an annual summit on economics. And a lot of the panel specialists came in and spoke, and they all made the same point. Technology is going to be a driving force in our economic future, and education is the key to maximizing the positive impact of technology. And we need to align our education and workforce development activities to ensure that young people graduating have the skills needed by employers in our region. The education organization that can best do this is, in my opinion, community college. That's why I think being part of the community college system is so exciting. We can be very flexible. We can respond to the needs of the community and the workforce in our community, so that they can better themselves by providing the right type of training, education, and I see the stop sign.
Thank you. Mr. Blount.
Yes, I wish it could be freer. I wish it could be as free as President Obama wants it to be. But I remember, I have one of the first student numbers at Cypress College, 65065. And boy, at the end of my certificate program, is like they raised it to $6 a class, and I was like, that's terrible. And I thought it was a crime that my books were $55 and now they're $185. I accept the challenge to see how close we can get it to free.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
In concept, I love the idea of a free community college education. But with like anything else, it's about execution. If it's paid for through the federal government, the federal budget, what is the budget for community colleges and how is that allocated? If this district ends up receiving less money, in the long run, then no, I'm not okay with it. If it receives somehow more money, then I am okay with it.
Thank you. Okay, the system up here is for me to take the most questions come in. The new questions go on the bottom of the stack. I take the question off the top. We are not going to have time to get to all the questions, so I'm shuffling. We have three questions on one subject in front of me, so I'm going to try and combine these, because obviously this is a topic a number of you want spoken about. The question is going to go to Mr. Wongbo first. It is to all candidates, and I'm simply going to ask you to speak about salaries for North Orange County Community College faculty and pensions. The questions relate to how they seem to feel that salaries are low, should be raised, how quickly, and how that interacts with funding public sector pensions. Good luck.
What was that last comment? Everybody wasn't laughing, I didn't hear that.
Public sector pensions.
Well, actually, it's a pretty simple question. If you can afford it, you can pay. You have to think about this kind of issues within the scope of how much do you have. For community college districts, the revenue source is set by the legislators in Sacramento. Even tuition is not set by the board. So you really have to think about the compensation of the employees, just like the city government. A big part of your expenses is labor related, personnel related, and a lot of it is pension related. So it's a very complex issue. I can go on and talk about pension issues because I've been working on it for a long time at the city level and also regional level. But it's not enough time. But I have heard a few things about the disparity between the full time faculty and the part time and. Stop sign again. You and I are going to be good friends.
Mr. Black.
Yes. In the Cypress School District, it goes through cycles, for better a term that comes to mind. But it's, you know, whatever the classifies and the certificated feel they need at the moment, or the particular year for particular contract period, because sometimes it's pensions, sometimes it's professional development, other times it's health benefits, and others it's you know, how you arrange the class environment, whether you have partnering with another teacher. And we're fortunate that we can talk about that, and it, and there's a free flow of communication, and we can work things out to what is important to, you know, you can't just say, well, pensions should be good, salaries should be good, health benefits, it's what the majority, what all can agree on.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
When you look at the surrounding districts for community colleges, North Orange County is the lowest paid one. That puts us at a very competitive disadvantage when hiring. The COLA, the cost of living adjustment, was less than 0.5% for the teachers in this district. That doesn't keep pace with inflation at all. When the economy, when there's a downturn in the economy in 2008, this district didn't have to lay anybody off. It didn't have to go to furloughs. It didn't have to shorten the school year. It didn't have to double class sizes or anything. The financial management of the district was such that it didn't need to do those things. But at the same time, salaries are low. We know that, that's not a question. Salaries are low in comparison, not just teachers across the board, but specifically for this district, when you compare it to the surrounding districts. If you want to hire the best teachers and do the best job to serve this community and these students, we have to do better than that.
Thank you. Mr. Salehi.
The time for proper compensation for our educators is now. The fact of the matter is that we have a general fund that supplies our budget. Now, as soon as that $500 million for capital improvement funds has been approved, we are now able to take existing capital improvement funds that were in the general fund and start to allocate them for different purposes. We have issues that we have, and we have tools where we can resolve them. Let's look at the administrators. The top five administrators are earning anywhere from $237,000 to up to $300,000 with all their benefits. That's close to what the President of the United States of America makes, when in fact, as it's been shown, our own educators are struggling to get by. You know, and often when someone hears that their neighbor is a professor or at a community college, they think that they're doing well. They don't realize that in our community, they're in many cases scraping to get by. That is outrageous, and we can and will make a difference together.
Thank you. This question may be our last, we'll see. It's a completely different subject, and it will be directed to Mr. Salehi. It is for all candidates. Where do you stand on armed campus safety of police officers on campus?
Given the recent tragedies that we've had in our country, I personally feel that safety is paramount to our education, to our students. I do not believe that the only response should be duck and hide and wait for someone to come get you. Our country has been built on the premises of being able to assert your ideas and assert your defense in the principles and the pursuit of democracy and for a better life. How can you do that if you have no defense? If we look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, we see that the most basic fundamental principle for moving up towards the ladders of self-actualization, to moving up to the highest levels of education, primarily and fundamentally lies on the concept of safety. Safety first. So we need to look, we need to examine, and we need to find a way to promote and to establish that safety for our students moving forward.
Thank you. Mr. Bongo.
I think a recent incident that we see throughout the world show us that there's no safe place miniature edition of weapons and the some people who's willing to sacrifice their own lives to hurt others. This will continue, unfortunately, this will be a part of our life for a long time. That's why I think public safety is going to be extremely important for not only this organization, but any organization. I think we have to continue to look forward to improve the public safety for our students and for our campuses, perhaps working with local governments, and also perhaps looking into having our own safe, safety staff on the campus as well. It's going to be, I'm afraid, it's going to be an ongoing issue for us, and we have to do our best job to protect the lives of the students and the faculty and all the workers on the campuses.
Thank you. Mr. Blunt.
Yeah, there are many things you can do to be safe, short of arming individuals to patrol campuses. And I'm an ambassador with the Cypress Chamber of Commerce, and we had a networking breakfast this morning, and our chief, Rod Cox, spoke to us and introduced his remarks by saying, when you walked in the room, did you check out where the exits were and what you needed to do in case of a live shooter? And it's a run, hide, fight is the procedure. But we can be aware of our surroundings, what we need to do individually to be safe, and be vigilant to report suspicious activity, and that goes a long way toward not having feeling necessary to have armed personnel on our campuses.
Thank you. Mr. Billings.
On my wife's campus, they have a police officer. Not armed security, not a private company, not somebody under contract trying to get the next contract. They have a police officer partnering with the city that they're in. They have somebody assigned to the campus that is armed and they can respond. It's somebody who's well trained, somebody who's gone through all the training, and specifically training for campuses and for schools. We have an obligation as leadership in the district to provide a safe environment for our students and our staff. There's nothing more paramount than that. And I would support police being on campus.
Thank you. That brings us to closing statements. And as I said in the beginning, we will have our closing statements in reverse order from our opening statements. The candidates have 1 minute for their closing statements, and our closing statements will begin with Al Sehi. Say a hi. I'm sorry, Mr. Sehi.
So am I. I think that we have a series of challenges ahead of us that we are equipped to fight for and to create a better tomorrow. I think that we have a range of issues that we need to look at. We have students who are dropping out right at the border time to be able to collect, for example, student aid, and then not continuing on with their classes. It's become a part-time job just to go and drop classes. We can stop government waste. We can look at our salaries and work in that field. We can look at technologies and work in that field. My phone number is 714-655-5702. That's my cell phone. I am here for you. You can call me. You can talk to me. We can work together. I will have brochures on the piano here, stage right, for you to take. And go to votesalehigh.com so that you can learn about how you can get involved in this campaign, in a campaign for the people, and help to create a better tomorrow and community together. I look forward to seeing you and working with all of you in the future.
Thank you. Actually, Mr. Sehi's brochures will be on the brochure table out in the hall. We don't allow any political brochures in the assembly room. Our next closing statement will be from Mr. Steve Wongbo.
I really enjoyed tonight's discussion. No doubt, community colleges and continuing education provides a very, very important service to our community. To paraphrase Dr. Bob Simpson, who's here tonight, president of Cypress College, community college is a special place that welcomes students from all backgrounds and with a variety of goals and needs. And I completely concur with our interim chancellor, Fred Williams. He loves to brag about community college education by saying, it is the best deal in town. As a longtime supporter of public education an experienced and innovative policymaker, I'd love to have an opportunity to help students of all ages to better themselves through educational and training opportunities. Again, my name is Steve Hongbo. I'm number 3 on ballot for Area 3. Thank you very much for your time. May God bless you and keep you.
Thank you. Mr. Stephen Blount.
As I want to take the League of Women's Voters for moderating and organizing and running this perfect forum, I've had many experiences with the league and with our moderator here. And I want to close with a quote, a testimonial from our current superintendent in the Cypress School District, Ann Siloff. The quote goes as follows. Steve Blount is an experienced public school district trustee with demonstrated leadership in physical supervision and bond oversight. As a member of the Cypress School District Governing Board, Steve monitored the modernization of our local schools. Furthermore, as trustee, Steve helped the district turn underutilized assets into an ongoing revenue stream that will support and enhance the educational program for students for generations to come. Without question, Steve Blount is a responsible steward of local resources and a strong advocate of public education. You can count on Blount.
Thank you. And our last person to give their closing statement this evening is Daniel Billings.
I'd like to thank everyone for attending. Thank you for taking the time and effort to be here, taking an interest in local politics and our district specifically. Donna Miller did this job for 18 years. She knows what it takes. She understands the rigors, and she's supporting me and endorsing me in this job. Mostly, I want to thank my wife. Without the love and support of you, I wouldn't be sitting here. You and I have a daughter. She's a year and a half. And if there's only one thing she learns from me, and there better be a lot more than one, but if there's only one, I want it to be this. The most important thing in life is to help other people. That's what I believe this district does, and it would be an honor for me to be part of it.
Thank you. To the audience, if your question was not asked, and a few were not, hopefully the candidates will stay around at the end a little bit, and perhaps you can get them answered then. On behalf of the North Orange County Community College District and the League of Women Voters of North Orange County, I'd like to thank these candidates for running, and I'd like you to join me. We have in this country a system of participatory governance, and if people such as these were not willing to stand and run for office to do the hard work of governing us, we would not be able to be the country that we are. So we owe them all a debt of our gratitude, regardless of who you choose to vote for. Thank you all for coming this evening and for giving us your attention and your fine questions. Thank you to our timekeepers and our question sorters, and particularly to the woman you see walking in front of you, Deborah, who was the organizer for tonight's event. You will find candidate literature and League of Women Voter literature out in the hall. Drive safely.